Welcome to A Friday Reads, where I do my weekly check-in. I talk about what I finished, what I'm reading, what I hope to get to. And this week it involves some tomes for Tome Topple coming up. And I always film these on Wednesday so that I can edit them before you guys see them Friday morning. And today I had a really important meeting and it went well. Thankfully, if you don't know, I'm a PhD candidate, and I do have a video about the research I do in my lab, so I'll link that up above if you're curious, but I'm pursuing a PhD in biophysics, and it's been a long road, and today I had the meeting where they were like, yes, schedule your defense, and I'm like, really? This is fantastic. Yes. So it's just a huge weight off my shoulder. I feel like I can start getting excited about the future. If you're a grad student in the United States, you kind of know that when you're in a PhD, sometimes you just feel stuck and like it will never end and you will never get out. And I can see the light and it's so exciting. It's just so exciting. And yeah, so that was a good day. I mean, I'm a little like exhausted now because of course I didn't sleep well last night and whatever, but I've been reading amazing things. I read so much last weekend, like I hoped. Did not vlog. That was not in the cards. There was no part of me that could. They didn't finish the bathroom till a day later, and then I was cleaning and I didn't want to vlog me cleaning. So that didn't happen, unfortunately, but I did read a bunch of things and we're going to talk about that today. First, we're going to talk about Flowers for the Sea, which I forgot to mention in last week's video. This is a novella that I read. I have an arc from NetGalley. I think it came out this week. If not, it's coming out next week. I don't actually remember which day. I feel like it came out on the 12th. I could be wrong. It could be the 18th. I remember it having a 1. The screen will correct me. This is a novella about this woman who is pregnant and kind of, you get the impression, not wanting to be pregnant on a boat because humanity lives on boats now because of some ending apocalyptic state, and that there is extreme prejudice on this boat against herself and like her people. And it's told in flashback, present day, you know, back and forth sort of style. I really liked the writing style. It really reminded me of writing styles similar to River Solomon really came to mind. It was like that, like if River Solomon and Jemison ever wrote a book together, with their writing style specifically, I think it would be this one. It thematically really reminded me of Solomon's Sorrowland. And I think it was good. I was really captivated while I was reading it, but I don't have much to say or reflect on now after I've finished it. And like, it's kind of one of those books that's left my head. It doesn't hold space up there anymore. It's kind of forgettable to me. But while I read it, I enjoyed it. I didn't mind the ending. I liked the writing style a lot. I just think I wish it would be longer. So I have a lot of novellas that I love because they perfectly fit the format, in my opinion, of a novella. Like, yes, this is a thought that should be explored in this many pages, and this is the appropriate amount of pages for this thought. And I felt like this would have been like a really solid, like 300, 350 page sci-fi that could really like have gotten me invested in the characters and the world and stuff. So I think this was a case of a novella that needed to be longer for it to stick with me, but it didn't do anything wrong, and I would still recommend it if the premise speaks to you and you kind of want this like Lovecraftian tale about motherhood sort of thing. Like if any of those things are like, those are my buzzwords, go check it out. So that was one that I finished before the weekend and I forgot to tell you guys about it. I also finished The Changeling by Victor LaValle. I think I talked about this in my end of the year tag earlier this week, but it was awesome. Everything I want from this time of year. Similar to the fairy tale, dark fairy tale-ness of Pan's Labyrinth is what you'll find here, but with like a different thematic focus. This is very much about fairy tales that try to help us figure out how to protect children. And you're following a man who is a new father, and some stuff happens, and you follow that, and it's very much a dark fairy tale, lots of suspense. I really like the ending, like, a lot. Like, there were definitely parts where I could have been like, maybe this is a little long, but also, like, it was pretty much a page-turner for me. But the ending, I thought, really worked. Because for me, sometimes endings don't work for books. They can be too fast or things like that. I can be very picky for no real reason. And I really liked it because it was satisfying for me and my tastes, but also left doors open for me to ponder things and still theorize, but without being frustrated. Like, I got enough answers and resolution for everything that was introduced, but I can still think about it. And like, I've talked to other people like Rachel and Tori, because I buddy read this with Tori and it was a recommendation from Rachel. And like, everyone kind of has like slightly different takes. And I think that's awesome. Like, I really like that. I remember last week I talked about how the beginning scared me, and that's true. there's a trope used at the beginning that's like a thing that scares me like all the time. And if you want to know, I can tell you, but I won't bring it up here. But after that, it became more dark fairy tale, unsettling, not really scary for me. Like, I was never scared again after the point that I told you guys I was scared last week. But I still really liked it. Perfect for this time of year. I'm going to try and get Ryan to read it next year because I think he'll really like it too. I also finished two Carmen Maria Machado's. I finally finished my reread of Her Body and Other Parties, and I read In the Dream House. Reading these back to back is really interesting. So this was a reread. I did a book club discussion on Rachel's channel. It was fantastic. I'll link it down below. We really just talk about the stories that resonated with us, what didn't work with us, what we would have loved to see more of, etc. This is a fantastic collection, I think, in terms of being cohesive in its thematic intentions, and I love that it has different narrative devices. I think because she put so much of herself and her life experiences into this, if a story resonates with you, it's unsettling to a different level. Like, that's the horror of this. Like, there are some grotesque and weird things happening in speculative space, but I think the stories that tend to freak people out the most are the ones where they see themselves in it and they feel a little called out, because this is definitely a book that's not afraid to go there, and it does it from so many angles, and I really love it. And then reading In the Dream House right after that was amazing, because it really informed some of the decisions that I had noticed in Her Body and Other Parties, like why certain elements were being highlighted in certain parts. Like, for example, there's a story in there about body dysmorphia and fat phobia that's internalized, and I didn't know that the author herself identifies as a fat woman. Like, I didn't know she was fat or skinny or whatever. I know she identifies as queer and Latina, and that's all I knew before reading the first collection. So that really informs that story. There's a whole story about residencies, and she's a writer, and she actually kind of talks about some of the residencies she goes through. But primarily, this is about an abusive relationship she went through. And it feels weird to say that I love this because, you know, it's about such a traumatic moment in this woman's life. But in terms of, like, art and the way that she chose to wordsmith it and the formatting of it and the intention behind it, it was amazing. I don't know. Like, and then there are just things that happened that I didn't expect. Like, I'm reading this work by this artist that I really, you know, admire after reading her short story collection. I find out she's also into Star Trek and Doctor Who like me. I see a lot of parallels between my life and hers, so that's part of it. But also just, like, having the book club discussion for this, there was a thing where I didn't notice it switches between first-person point of view and second-person point of view. And that's actually, like, there's a section called Dream House as Experiments in Perspective. And then all of a sudden, the last page, the ending of this book, made so much more sense to me. And I don't know. It's my type of literary, experimental writing style stuff. Like, I know that I will look at this again down the line. It's an important piece of work for me. I think it also accomplishes what its goal is. Like, in itself, its goal is to add to the canon. This is my story of being abused in a relationship with a woman as a woman, because it is kind of, you know, I think we all actually believe that, yes, anyone can abuse another person in a relationship. But that's not the stereotype. And honestly, it's usually, like, assumed that it can't happen. She actually has a lot of legal cases to back up that point in here. And also, abuse isn't always being physically abused, and that's another big part of this book. So, I don't know. It was fantastic. I wouldn't change a thing about it. I thought it was lovely, and she narrates it herself, so I immersion read this. I did the audio while reading it. I did actually read the choose your own adventure part, because the audio only goes through one path of that. And this also has footnotes that aren't in the audiobook. I really liked it. So I think I might try, if I ever get myself together, to do a video on both of these. I think these are both incredibly personal works. And I trust her as, like, a person who puts words together on a page, as an author. And I would read anything else she puts out. But I'm curious if she will always put things out that have that really strong personal connection, or if it'll be something else. Like, I have no idea if she's working on something and that will make it to the public eye at any point, but really great. I also finished two audiobooks. So I finished Lady Trent number 4, and all I will say is, it was so good. So good. I'm going to start the fifth one today. I guess spoiler for the next part of the video. I'm starting the fifth one soon. But the fourth one, was lovely. It might be my favorite. I think the second one's still my favorite. They're all neck and neck. They're all the same level of super fun quality. 4 to 4.5 stars. Love reading them. Again, I say you must read them in order, especially because of book 4. My coworker was so glad I told her not to, because when I told her not to, I hadn't even finished book 4. But now finishing book 4, if you've read it, you know. And like, so good. And so I picked up Certain Dark Things by Silvia Moreno-Garcia and finished that too. So I was concerned that I wouldn't really like this one because I have only read one other fantasy by her, and that was Gods of Jade and Shadow. Mexican Gothic, I think, is more speculative horror, but you can include that in fantasy as you want. But I did like that one a fair bit, but more because I liked that it was like an Alfred Hitchcock thriller, which is different than liking a fantasy. And Gods of Jade and Shadow was very much a questing fantasy story, which is not my vibe. And this one, I didn't know what it was about. I knew it had vampires, and it was in Mexico City, and she refers to it as a neo-noir. I didn't really know what that meant. What it meant to me is that I had a really good time, and I don't know if that's because I listened to the audiobook or if because this is the story that has multiple POVs, and I was really attached to, like, a few of them. And I liked the setting a lot, so this felt to me, and I don't know why it felt this way, it could be very wrong, but, like, kind of a cyberpunk Mexico City. It's not like super futuristic or anything, but it had that sense about it because it does feel tiny bit like future post-apocalyptic-y, and there's definitely like internet cafes and like I don't know, it had that vibe. Like if you've watched Repo, the Genetic Opera, it has that vibe. That's what it felt like to me. And we have different types of vampires and different lore. They're very different from vampire lore, and I was prepared for that, and I enjoyed it. It was relatively easy for me to keep track of, but there is a glossary at the back too, which is always helpful. And there's Domingo. I love Domingo. Domingo is so sweet. There's also a dog. But, like, Domingo is this, like, it's just so sweet. And I loved the ending he got. And it's probably Domingo. I really liked Domingo. He's just so soft. And I really liked him. And so I don't know if it's because it was an audio that I liked this better. I have no clue. And there's not really a plot. Like, the plot is very simple. The plot is, I mean, I don't even know if I should talk about it, but there's, like, a vampire girl. She ends up in Mexico City. There shouldn't be vampires in Mexico City. And she's running away from people, and she's in trouble. And then Domingo, this human, stumbles upon her and gets wrapped up in it all. That's, like, the plot. It felt like, to me, also, like, a more vibrant underworld. Like, I love that movie, too, where it's, like, vampire girl, and then this dude who gets, like, messed up and stuff. Although that's a much darker film. Again, like The Changeling, really good for me in this time of year. Like, that's just the type of vibe that works really well for me, and it was done well. So this might be my favorite Silvia Moreno-Garcia, and I think that's an unpopular opinion, maybe? I don't know. But I like it better than Mexican Gothic, although I gave both of those 4 stars. And I like Gods of Jade and Shadow, like, at a 3.5 star. Like, it's good. So I think those are all the things I finished. Like I said, I read a lot, and then I'm still reading things. I have not continued in House of Chains, but I will be reading that next week because it's part of my Tome Topple, because I definitely have more than 500 pages left. I just got wrapped up in The Changeling. That's what took over my brain. I also started Vita Nostra, which I want to finish before Tome Topple on Monday, which should be doable. I'm about halfway. What to say about Vita Nostra? I'll put up a picture since I don't think this is very useful. It's dark academia, and it's really interesting. It's definitely a commentary on education. At least I feel that. As a grad student, I was like, yeah, I see myself in this person. But it's also not like traditional school. I'm halfway through, and I actually don't feel like, I think, as confused as most people are. Like, I mean, I don't know what's happening, but I don't feel uncomfortably confused. There definitely is stuff that we're not meant to understand, but, like, neither does the main character. So I feel, like, appropriately confused, and I'm kind of prepared to not have answers, because it's the type of confusion that, like, I'm okay being in, and I don't need a resolution. I'm really curious where it's going, and I'm liking following this person on this journey at this place. And there's a lot of good, I don't want to say fall vibes, it has all of the seasons, but the whole going to school and meeting people and dealing with the trials and stresses of school is a big part of this story. I mean, add on to it a bunch of weird, confusing things, so I'm liking that. I was thrown at first. I didn't know if I would like it at the first couple pages because it read very literary for a bit, and I was like, literary fantasy is not my jam. It's really not. I can read literary sci-fi, I can read literary fiction, I can read literary historical fiction. Literary fantasy is just, like, not my thing. But it didn't stay that way, and then I got very invested in her journey. Her name is Sasha, and just, like, I can relate to her a lot, and I think a lot of how things are described are relatable enough. Like, there are certain experiences she goes through that you can't relate to, but I can relate to some things like it, I think. I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen next. It's not like I could describe what's happening or make sense of it, but I feel like how I felt when I read Nine Fox Gambit, but maybe a little bit less confused than when I read Nine Fox Gambit. Don't know if that's a pro or con. I also started City of Lies, although I put it on pause because I really wanted to finish Vita Nostra before Tome Topple. So, and this is a tome, so I can read this for Tome Topple. I think I will like this. So, again, this is one where I didn't know if my brain was just burnt out or whatever, but I got the audiobook to immersion read for a bit because I was just having problems getting into it. I'm only two chapters in. Granted, two chapters in for this book is like, I don't know, 80 pages. So they're pretty long chapters. And we've got, so far, Jovin and Kalina. And I really like these characters. One has anxiety and seems to be neurodivergent, and the other one is immunocompromised. And I think those are interesting traits, especially for their occupation as a family. They're supposed to be proofers, so they check for poisons and stuff like that. And the start of this book, you know right away something's gone down, and you're like reliving the day up to the thing that goes down. And now we're in the mystery of like how, why, what happened. And it's giving me like Mask of Mirror adjacent vibes. Now I say that I don't love this yet as much or as quickly as I love the Mask of Mirrors, but in terms of the politicking and in terms of like the main characters and the platonic relationships, I'm getting those vibes. So it's scratching that itch for me. Time will tell if I love it as much or if it's just going to be a solid 4-star fantasy experience. I am intrigued though. I'm very intrigued about this. I need to know more, but I am going to really stick my nose in this after I finish Vita Nostra. So, Tome Topple so far, the plans that I've shown you guys, City of Lies, House of Chains. And then, I'm for sure, I've been waiting and it's happening. It's in my hands and I'm a little nervous because not everyone in the Discord has been liking it. I have been like cautiously like looking through, but like also waiting until I've had a chance to read it. And it's Ninth Rain, which if you don't know, we are doing a buddy read on the channel for the whole trilogy, assuming we like it. Like if I don't like the book, I'm not going to keep going. But Ninth Rain is a tome. I don't know what it's about. I'm not looking it up. I'm just going to read it. I hear it's genre blendy. And, you know, it made Elle cry, I'm pretty sure. Like, the people who have liked it have really liked it. And I think the people who have not liked it have not really disliked it, but they didn't feel, like, compelled to keep going. So, here's hoping. I'm very excited. Like, I'm picking it up on Monday. I'm very, very pumped. It's going to be great. So that's, like, a longer Friday reads than normal. So, but it is what it is. Thank you guys for all the well wishes last week when I was having my rough week. Yeah. And for all you guys who were watching my video on Wednesday, my new exhalation recommendations video. That was a video I did for me. It's a video that I knew is a little niche and won't get as many like clicks or whatever. But like when the subscriber, Sarah As You Wish, suggested it, I was like, yes, this is a video I must do. Yes. And I was so happy to put it together. And all of the comments have been so great. It's just awesome getting to gush about stuff that I love. So let me know, my hair tie just went flying, what your plans are for the weekend, reading, watching, hanging out with friends vibes. I'm hoping to play some board games, and we've got some plans with friends. Hopefully I'll still be able to read. Balancing, I want to just chill and do nothing with I want to be social is like a constant struggle here. And if you just want to leave an emoji to let me know you're here, leave a house for In the Dream House, because I really loved that book. I really loved it. Like, I was hoping I would love it, but, like, it's pretty perfect. It was pretty perfect for what it is and what it tried to do. Like I don't normally, like, feel comfortable rating memoirs because they're memoirs, but, like, that's a solid 5-star memoir right there. And otherwise, like if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.